in the same booklet, number 35. I'm not aware that we've done this song before, but maybe we have. It was somewhat new to me. I would like for us to go through this once because we'll be singing this later in the service. So Beth will outline it for us first. Number 92, and sing The Journey, Just As I Am. Now in the hymnal number 349, 349.
Thank you. Out of the depths I cry to you, O Lord, hear my voice. I wait for the Lord. My soul waits for the Lord more than those who watch for morning, more than those who watch for morning. Nearer and nearer we come to the place where death is confronted head on. And as we move one step closer to the crux of despair, we join hands to walk together, to breathe together, to worship the God of life together. It is therefore fitting that we gather on this, the fifth Sunday of Lent, to worship God here together at College Mennonite Church on the campus of Goshen College. So whether you have come to this physical sanctuary or whether we become sanctuary for each other as we gather remotely, either way, come from near and far, from the edge of despair or the edge of relief, from the depths of confusion or the margins of hope. Come worship God together, the source of our life, the source of our courage, the source of our every breath. Please turn in your bulletin to the call to worship printed there, and let's read this together. Come, bring your weary bones and your crushed souls. Now is the time to worship the life-giving Spirit. Ahora es tiempo de adorar al Espíritu que da vida. Come, bring your dashed hopes and broken dreams. Now is the time to worship the life-giving Spirit. Ahora es tiempo de adorar al Espíritu que da vida. Come, bring your heavy sorrow and your lingering sadness. Now is the time to worship the life-giving Spirit. Ahora es tiempo de adorar al Espíritu que da vida. Bring all that you have and all that you are. The Spirit is here to breathe life into all that is lifeless. Please pray with me. We gather to meet you, to honor you, to breathe your Spirit in our lives as we sing songs to you, O God. Fill this space, even as you fill our lungs with your powerful, enlivening breath. Receive our praise and inspire our worship of you. In your holy name, Lord Jesus, we pray. Amen. I invite you to take your blue hymnals and turn to number 26, Holy Spirit, Come with Power. And if you are able, please stand.
Number 26.
Thank you.
Now please turn in to Sing the Journey, number 35, 35, O Breath of Life.
There is lots for us to hold before God in these days. So I invite you to join with me in praying together. And if you're comfortable, I would invite you to hold your hands open, resting either on your lap or higher. But recognize that when we come to prayer, we are coming to place all that we have and all that we hold in the holy hands of God. God of life, we long for you. In these days when we seem to hear more bad news than good, we can easily find ourselves unintentionally wallowing in the depths of despair. And so we come to you, needing to know you and the life and love that are your essence. Give us eyes to see signs of your life and love all around us. Give us ears to hear whispers of your life and love each day. Give us hearts to sense the gentle power of your life and love sustaining us regardless of circumstances. And with each breath we receive from you, moment by moment, fill us with the power of your life and love, so that we might walk these days in confidence of your presence with us. We hold in the power of your love Caleb Ganawan as he prepares to receive his second round of chemotherapy this week. Give his young body strength to effectively receive this medication. We also pray for strength and courage and patience for Chica and Martin and Matthew and Chica's parents as they walk alongside Caleb in these days. We also pray for Betsy Troyer as she recovers after a stay in the hospital this week. Bring healing to her body and courage to her soul. We hold in your love the families and friends of those who have recently passed from this life to the next, asking that you would surround the families and friends with comforting love as they grieve this their loss and live into new arrangements of normal. For Josiah Kawira's family and friends, whose memorial service was yesterday, for the family and friends of Rosemary Zook, whose visitation is today and whose funeral is tomorrow, for family and friends of Shirley Gingrich, whose visitation and funeral will be held April 14 and 15, for Elvira Hirschberger's family and friends, whose visitation will be held April 8th, and for friends and family of MJ Sharp, who was recently killed while engaged in peace-building work in the Democratic Republic of Congo, and whose service of remembrance will be held Saturday, April 15th, in Heston, Kansas, at Heston Mennonite Church. Hold our sadness and our tears in your merciful hands, signs of love for those who have been a part of our lives and through whom we have experienced love. We know that each and every day of our lives, something blooms and something else returns to the earth. In days shrouded in darkness and death, we are compelled, even driven, to search for life. And so we search for the buds emerging on the trees, for the crocuses persisting forth from the winter soil, for the daffodils courageous enough to burst forth in color from the closed jackets of winter to stand out as beacons of bold light amidst the dormant and dead leaves around them. We celebrate when we see signs of hope and life around us. For the gathering of the Minority Ministries Council this past weekend, for the sacred stories shared, the holy tears shed, and the life-giving challenge and encouragement passed on to the next generation of leaders. We celebrate the arrival of Mennonite pastor Luis Tapia this week from Quito, Ecuador. Luis will be serving as an intern among us in these next months, and we pray that you would grant him traveling mercies and help us to welcome him well. We celebrate the completion of a full and rich season of Wednesday night gatherings, wherein we were graced with the opportunity to sit at the table of the other, particularly Goshen College students. We pray for these students as they enter their final weeks of classes, as the semester begins to draw to a close. We celebrate your spirit among us, calling us, leading us, empowering us to reach out with generous hospitality to all who enter our doors. Continue to inspire us with your welcoming spirit. And help us, O God, to position ourselves to see the life in the contrast to the death all around, to see light in contrast to the darkness, to see flowers bloom in contrast to the dead leaves remaining around us, trusting that that which returns to the earth does so offering sustenance and energy for that which remains, longing to reveal full display of your glory, longing to bring beauty to the world, longing to bloom. We pray all of these things and so many more that rest on our hearts in your holy and loving and life-giving name, Lord Jesus. Amen. As the children come forward for children's time, I invite you to turn to the green Sing the Journey book, number 29, and sing together, "You Are All We Have."
Number 29. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. I have a story for you this morning, and I've got some pictures to go with it. So while I'm reading this story to you, I want you to check out my pictures up on the screen. They're going to help us tell the story, okay? One day, Jesus received a message from Mary and Martha. "Jesus, please come quickly. Lazarus is very sick." But Jesus stayed where he was for 2 more days. Then Jesus traveled to the place where Mary and Martha lived. Martha went to meet him. She was crying. Martha said to Jesus, "My dear brother has died. If you had been here, you could have healed him." Jesus was sad, and Jesus cried too. Psst, this is my favorite part of the story. I like this part of the story because what it tells us is when we feel sad, Jesus and God feel sad too. But we'll keep going because something really cool is going to happen. Then Jesus walked over to Lazarus's tomb and he said to them, "If you believe, you will see the glory of God." He told some men to roll away the stone, and Jesus prayed out loud, "Father, I know you always hear me. Now show everyone that you have sent me." Then Jesus shouted, "Lazarus, come out!" And Lazarus walked out of the tomb covered in burial clothes. He was alive again. Everyone was amazed. Many people believed in Jesus that day. If you believe, you will see the glory of God. Mary and Martha believed. They believed that Jesus was the Messiah. They believed that Jesus was sent by God to teach us about God, to teach us how to live. But you know, sometimes it can be hard to believe. Have any of you ever seen God before? Have you seen a figure of God in front of you? I see a lot of heads shaking no. I haven't seen God before either. But I want you to know something, that just because you can't see something doesn't mean it's not there. Your great-grandpa Zook is seeing God now, yes. Our theme for today is we breathe, and you each have a picture of someone breathing in some way, blowing bubbles, blowing air. Can you take those pictures to Talasha? And we're gonna put those down for this mural that we're creating. We're gonna talk about our breath and tie that into what I just said. So go get those pictures stuck down. And then once you have it stuck down, come back up to the front. We have been working to create this beautiful collage for Lent, and I think soon we are going to start to see what that looks like. But I have a question for you. Are you breathing? Are you breathing? Raise your hand if you are breathing. Okay, phew. We are breathing. How do you know you're breathing? Can you see your breath right now? No. Well, then how do you know that you're breathing? How do you know, Matthew? Oh, you are smart. He's getting ahead of me. Go ahead and stand up. We're going to try something. I'm going to show you something. I want you to run in place as fast as you can. Run, run. Okay, now do some jumping jacks. Jumping jacks, jumping jacks. Good, now run. And a couple more jumping jacks. Okay, sit down. Are you breathing? How do you know you're breathing? Can you see your breath? No, how do you know? Malachi can feel his heart beating. What if you put your hand in front of your mouth? I don't know about you, but I feel my breath. God's kind of like this. There are times that we don't see God, but we feel God. Just like we feel our breath on our hands and we feel our hearts. Let's try something else. Now let's see if I can do this after I've been running. This. Can you see my breath? What do you see?
It's a balloon.
You see the balloon? You can't see my breath, but my breath has filled this balloon. God's kind of like that too. You know that God's love and God's spirit can fill each of you and can fill people in this room just like this balloon. Now, the crazy Church of the Brethren in me wanted every person in this sanctuary to have a balloon. But my Mennonite husband told me that this might be seen as wasteful or excessive. So I've toned it down. Each of the kids can go get a balloon from Talasha, and I've spread some balloons out around the sanctuary. If you have a balloon by you, could you blow some air into that balloon and hold it up so that we can see it? Kids, can you blow some air into your balloons and hold them up so we can see them? See if you can get some air in those. I want you to look around this sanctuary, and I want you to know that in the same way that we have filled these balloons with air, God fills us, and God fills people around us. Kids, I want you to take your balloon. It'll give you something to do during the sermon. But I want you, if you only hear one thing from me today, I want you to know this. I want you to remember that when things are hard, when people we love are sick, or they die. And we ask that question of where is God? I want you to remember these balloons. And I want you to remember what Jesus said. Jesus said, if you believe, you will see the glory of God. Amen. Let's pray. Dear God, we thank you so much for your word and for your story. We thank you that you are always with us. Help us to open our eyes and open our hearts to feel you and to see you, even when things are hard. Thank you for loving us. In Jesus' name, amen. Kids, you can get your worship bags, and I also have a picture for you to color.
Please turn to Sing the Journey in number 32, If You Believe and I Believe.
I invite you to turn in your bulletin to the prayer of confession printed there. I'll read the leader part and invite the congregation to read the people part. John and Sarah and Marty will be readers up here at the front. Let's pray together. God, we confess that when we look into the valleys of our lives, we are tempted to fix our gaze on the remnants of our past. We see the dry bones and we doubt in our minds, will these bones ever live? But in the midst of our doubt, we proclaim that you are the life-giving Spirit. You breathe new life into all that is dead.
For you, O God, raised up the dry bones in the valley.
Your Son, Jesus,
brought Lazarus out from the tomb.
And your Spirit lifted anew the hearts of the disciples.
Teach us, O Lord, to wait for your breath. Blow your mighty wind into the hollow chambers of our hearts, that we may never settle for death, but rise again as your beloved people. God, holy breath, restore us. But with you, O God, there is forgiveness, so that we can with humble reverence serve you once more. In you there is unfailing love and full redemption. You redeem us from all our sin and all that is broken within us, and empower us to live as your children. Thanks be to God. Amen.
I am pleased this morning to introduce John Powell as our preacher. John currently serves as a regional conference minister for Indiana-Michigan Mennonite Conference. He and his wife Shirley live in Ypsilanti, Michigan, where they attend the Ann Arbor Mennonite Church. There are many things that I could say about John, but I want to give him time for his sermon. But he has a long history of working for the church. John has been a civil rights worker, a member of the Minority Ministries Council, a professor, and many more. Most of all, John's life has been a reflection of his beliefs, even when it cost him a job or put his life in danger. He is truly a man of God, and we are blessed to have him share with us this morning. John, let me pray with you. God, we are grateful for John and his many years of service to you and your church. We ask that you open our minds and hearts this morning to hear your message through your servant, John. Amen.
Amen. Thank you.
I'm going to be reading from Ezekiel 37, 1 to 14. The hand of the Lord came upon me, and he brought me out by the Spirit of the Lord and set me in the middle of the valley. It was full of bones. He led me all around them, where there were many lying in the valley, and they were very dry. He said to me, "Mortal, can these bones live?" I answered, "O Lord God, you know." Then he said to me, "Prophesy to these bones and say to them, 'O dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. Thus says the Lord God to these bones, I will cause breath to enter you, and you shall live. I will lay sinews on you, and you will cause flesh to come upon you and cover you with skin, and put breath in you, and you shall live, and you shall know that I am the Lord.' So I prophesied as I had been commanded. And as I prophesied, suddenly there was a noise, a rattling, and the bones came together, bone to its bone. I looked, and there were sinews on them, and flesh had come upon them, and skin had covered them, but there was no breath in them. Then he said to me, 'Prophesy to the breath, prophesy, mortal, and say to the breath, Thus says the Lord God, Come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe upon these slain, that they may live.' I prophesied as he commanded me, and the breath came into them, and they lived and stood on their feet, a vast multitude. Then he said to me, 'Mortal, these bones are the whole house of Israel. They say, Our bones are dried up, and our hope is lost. We are cut off completely. Therefore, prophesy and say to them, Thus says the Lord God, I am going to open your graves and bring you up from your graves, O my people, and I will bring you back to the land of Israel. And you shall know that I am the Lord when I open your graves and bring you up from your graves, O my people. I will put spirit within you, and you shall live, and I will place you on your own soil. Then you shall know that I, the Lord, have spoken and will act, says the Lord.
Good morning. I bring you greetings from Shalom Community Church in Ann Arbor. I bring you greetings from congregations across Indiana-Michigan Conference. But most of all, I bring you greetings from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. When I started asking myself, how would I begin this sermon, I had a number of places and a number of things that I wanted to begin with, and there were a number of little anecdotes that I wanted to say, and I thought that I might just do this. Do you know what it means when a black preacher takes off his watch? Absolutely nothing. It's been a while since I have been here, and a lot of water has passed over the dam. A lot of lives have seen God's glory, and a lot of us have had our eyes open and our dry bones filled with spirit again. Now, when you heard the scripture being read this morning, what came to your mind? Was there anything that may have come to your mind? Okay. Any question that you would have wanted to ask? Well, most of us have heard of Death Valley, right? There have been stretches and stretches of days when Death Valley has reached temperatures over 120 degrees. The early pioneers going on their way toward the west, many didn't make it because they got caught up in the heat. They didn't have enough water to survive. And they died. It is said that you should probably not go into, even today, into Death Valley with ample supply. Well, I want to suggest to you this morning that the story of Ezekiel in the Valley of Dry Bones is familiar to almost everyone. But we ask ourselves, how does this all relate to us? What does this have to do with us? Well, I said that most of us have heard of Ezekiel in the Valley of the Dry Bones. Even if you haven't engaged in biblical study, we were probably confronted with the story in summer camp, and we sang the song Dim Bones. Various parts of the body were dried up and disconnected. And the song ended up by saying, now hear the word of the Lord. I want to submit to you this morning that this story is about God's continued promise to instill God's Spirit in God's people that gives new vision, hope, and witness towards God's preferred future. And by the way, God has a preferred future. And one of the things that's so disturbing oftentimes is that we think that God's preferred future is the future that we design. Now, just a little background here. God had brought Israel out of Egyptian captivity and made them a nation again. Judah rediscovered the source of his strength under King Uzziah, Josiah. However, that didn't last long. That didn't last long at all. And they prayed and they fell into the destruction around them. It's like people who have everything in the world that can offer. They turned away from God. And their homeland was destroyed. And the survivors, including Ezekiel, was taken into captivity. Living hopelessly, they were living dead. As their hopes were dashed, they questioned God, and I'm just going to suspect that they very well may have cursed God. This is a condition that Ezekiel lived in and ministered in. His message as he talked to them wasn't a message of, I'm okay and you are okay. And his message was really a hard message to them. Our whole book says that he was led to this valley of dry bones and right in the midst, and he was placed there, and these bones were there, and God gave him a vision and said to him, Ezekiel, look around you. Look at all of these bones, how dry they are. Can they live again? And I would imagine, trembling, Ezekiel said, God, only you know whether they can live again. Now, God told him what's going to happen. And he said, prophesy among them. I want you to tell them in reality that all is not lost. This is not an unfamiliar picture. I want to submit to you this morning that exploring the text and looking into the mirror, this very well may be the life that we are living today. Our communities, particularly our Christian communities, seem to be in shambles. Left and right theologies have taken over, and the voice of God seemingly is at a distance from us. We hear all kinds of voices, but somehow the voice of God get lost in all of the stuff that we hear. It feels like that we are in Death Valley, desolate and dry places. Well, I would say that for us to be in dry places and in Death Valley, something must have happened before. It must have been somehow ignoring the voice of God around us. So before going into this valley of death, some of us may have gone into this valley with security. They brought their water of security with them, wealth, like-minded people and friends, their own religion. They don't thirst, at least not for the time being, they don't thirst. And then there are other people who come into this valley with us. They are the people who are thirsting for justice and righteousness. And in the midst of this, in the midst of all of this surrounding, we see vultures. Vultures of despair. Vultures of isolation, injustice, and destruction circling around us, just waiting for the hordes to die. And we want to sit here and we say, God, can you help me out of this mess? And God very well may say, look, I didn't get you into this mess. You got yourself into this mess, but I am not going to desert you. So we walk around in this valley as the living dead, existing without peace, without faith, without compassion, and without hope. But wait, let me ask you a question. Are we living without hope? What if a modern day Ezekiel came into this church today and said, I'm here to show you how to find water and how to help you out of the deserted valley? Might we say, well, okay. I have money and I have friends, I have physical security, I have good family relationships, and a fairly safe environment. And Ezekiel, this modern day Ezekiel, very well might say, well, yes. That may be true. That's good news, and that's bad news. And I would suspect that if you are like me, you would say, look, I don't appreciate the fact that you come in and disturb my peace. I was here worshiping God, enjoying the beautiful music, looking at my good friends that I have had all of my life. And now you come in and take over this worship. I'm going to submit to you, this interruption in our lives very well may be something that causes us to ponder about how we have become part of the disconnected, how we have become part of the valley of dry bones. If our dry bones are and disconnected bodies are to become fully functional again, we need to open ourselves up to be interrupted. Divine interruption. Interrupted by God, who will provide with us with God's replenishing spirit. The church for too long has been a primary sanctuary for many who have lost hope. However, somehow, just somehow, the church has lost its standing. It has difficulty standing in the gap for God. So we are desperately seeking restoration. And we know that restoration will come, but we don't know how it's going to happen. We have been weakened by a racially, religiously, culturally divided world. The sad fact is that today. No, the good news is that I didn't save a lot of money by switching to Geico. The good news is this, that the valley of dry, withered souls and dead spirits is not the end of our story. It's the beginning. It's the beginning of our story. Because we are in this valley of dry bones together. We are looking at how parched we have become. We are looking at each other with dry eyes and tears. And we say to ourselves, I long to have water, and I long to be refreshed and replenished with spirit, but I don't know where to turn. And there is a brother or there is a sister who is totally different from you and saying, all you gotta do is to look at me. I am here to help you find that source of strength. I am here to help you find that water that will give you life. I am here because God has sent me to you. Now, you may not like it. By the way, I'm talking about me. I don't like sometimes when people infringe on who I think that I am. Because it makes me have to face who I am. And if we are going to be restored and get out of this valley and be replenished again with God's Spirit, we have to realize that this time is only temporary. And we have to also realize that we have to deal with issues of no longer. Christian speaker Frank Viola reminds us that this can be a place for religious detox. we can shed our religious baggage. And by the way, I know that I have a lot of religious baggage. You see, I think I'm the greatest thing that's happened to this world since peanut butter. But I also realize that there are a lot of people that don't like peanut butter. And in such a life, we have to be able to live in what I call no longer. No longer live for yourself. No longer regard people as different, saying, they are not my kind. I don't know them. I don't want to know them. And we have no longer right to be judging other people about keeping score. The valley of death and dry bones can become a bright spot for everyone. That is, if we seek, observe, and hang on to the one whom God sent to rescue us, Jesus. God's Spirit will revive us again. As creatures being restored again, the mirage of hope we see in the desert will in fact become living waters and rekindle life so that we can live like God wants us to live. Our self-sufficiency is dashed and we are able to conform to the image of God. That's what God wants of us. God is not predictable in this midst. We are forced to give up this idea that God is predictable and that we can predict the score, the final results. And sometimes we have trouble seeing God because we have created a God removed from the cares and the realities that we face. That's why Ezekiel's words come to remind us that maybe, just maybe, God is saying, I'm trying to tell you something. You're not alone. In your world, a world that has been turned upside down, I'm here. Can't you see me? Turn around. Receive the security I will give you. If we get scorched by the heat of the desert of life and distractions, by God's grace and mercy and forgiveness, we will pick each other up. That's what God has put us here for, to pick each other up, to shoulder the concerns, to shoulder the burdens that each and every one of us have. And I don't know about you, but that's all I need to know. That's all I need to know. That God is there. That God is in you. That God is in each and every one of you, providing a sense of direction and providing a sense of hope, even though you may not be able to see it. And as I close, I want to close with this. At the wedding of Cana, Jesus confronted his mother with a simple message. And simply put this, and I would ask you to go back and read this encounter. But the message is this. When you are in the valley of dry bones and want to get out, don't tell God what to do. Just do what God tells you to do. When you are in that valley of dry bones, do what God tells you to do. When you are in that valley of dry bones, prepare yourself to be filled. Empty yourself out. Become an empty vessel for the fullness of what God is ready and willing and able to do. And then finally just sit back. Sit back and watch what God will do. Watch what God will do. Because God is waiting for you, brothers and sisters, to open up your lives, to open up to the fullness of what God wants you to be. And how God wants you to be. It's temporary. The stuff that's happening in our lives, no matter where it is, whether it is political, whether it is social, or whether it is religious, is temporary. Because God has your back. God has my back. And together, we will get out of the valley of death together. And together, God will restore these dead, dry bones. May it be so.
Let's respond by singing in the blue hymnal, number 372, O Healing River, and I invite you to stand.
Thank you. I'm Catherine Ashleman, happy to remind you that April is the month of the young child. We are here to testify to seeing God at work at CCYC Arbor Ridge, located in the La Casa Arbor Ridge neighborhood, west of the main entrance of the Everence office in North Goshen. It is a satellite program of our own campus center for young children housed in our building. Arbor Ridge provides EduCare for 30 plus children, 5 months to 5 years old, while their parents are at work. Both centers are open from 7 a.m. to 5:30 p.m., Monday through Friday. In 2016, during the Week of the Young Child, April 10 to 16, we saw God's love and grace abound as we visited the Arbor at Arbor Ridge. Olivia Cruz provided the graphics for this presentation. Shirley Friesen is standing in for Phyllis Miller, who couldn't be here today. Phyllis reported on Music Monday, "I was pleased to see the staff ready for the children to do the music activities when I got there. Everyone entered in enthusiastically. As Amber Bowers, the director, noted, she sees God at work through the patience, compassion, and respect for children demonstrated by her staff. Concerning Taco Tuesday, Sandy Hess realized, I saw God working in me as I related to the young children. We helped them work together at making a black bean dip. Some of them were even brave enough to eat it on taco chips. Yes, we may be changed as we sit at the table of the other. Working together Wednesday, Julie Gundon observed, the children at Arbor Ridge quickly showed their creativity as they adapted the activity that was planned for their working together time. One group used milk jug caps to create a pattern. An older group dug dandelions out of their garden, then arranged them according to the length of the roots. Finding a few earthworms in this activity made it even more exciting. Working together, children discovered God at work in creation as they explored what happens underground. Artsy Thursday, Margaret Ingold noticed the Waddlers seemed very interested in the art project. Properly attired in paint smocks, it was impressive to see the children so young work so long dipping old empty thread spools into paint to make prints on paper. Yes, washcloths were handy to wipe off mouths and arms and hands. God has certainly endowed children with enthusiasm and creativity and curiosity, requiring the guidance of patient, understanding adults. Family Friday. Vera Smucker read books about families to the children on the playground as they took breaks from play. Shirley Friesen remembered another occasion when the children were painting halves of car tires with bright yellow paint to be put into a large circle, making a place for a flower bed. I was helping a four-year-old boy, Shirley recalled, until his father arrived to be a part of this operation. Presently, with 29% of the children at Arbor Ridge coming from single-parent homes, I welcome men to consider visiting Arbor Ridge during the last week of April, this year's Week of the Young Child. The invitation is open to all who would like to go with me to meet eager children, 31% from culturally diverse backgrounds. Please contact me before Easter so a schedule for April 24 to 28 can be arranged with Arbor Ridge. God is at work.
Thank you. I invite us at this time to bring our offerings forward while the Shalom Ringers plays offertory. If you are able and would like to bring your offering, walk it forward, please do. If not, the ushers and children will be in the crowd to bring your offering up.
Thank you.
God of life, we are grateful for the life that you breathe into us, particularly when death looms close at hand and we feel parched and in a weary land. May your healing, reviving spirit move in our midst and touch us, enabling us to know the restoration, the new life that comes from you. Receive our lives and all that we are, and all that we do, and all that we have, as a sign of our worship of you. In your holy, reviving, life-giving name we pray. Amen. I invite you to turn in your hymnal worship book to number 418 and sing together, "Move in Our Midst, O Spirit of God," 418. Of the Spirit who inspires life into all that is lifeless. Go enlivened, invigorated, refreshed, and restored. Go in peace. Amen.